Stand from 4 o'clock right here in class. Today, first of all, as you can see the sign right here, I want to give a huge thank you to the Claire Booth Luce Policy Institute for organizing today's talk. They've helped us out a couple times in the past. I'm very appreciative of the Institute. And there are flyers up front and brochures if you are interested in finding out more about the Institute. Today's speaker, who they are sponsoring and helped fly in, she just flew in from Wisconsin, is Rachel Campos Duffy is here today. And you may recognize her from television. Those of you who ever watch television, she is a Fox News and Fox Business contributor. Any Fox News people out there? Right there, all right. She also got her start in television on MTV's reality show, The Real World. Some of you may remember that. She's been a frequent guest on NBC's Today Show. And for 14 years, she was a recurring guest host of The View. Okay? Keep going. She is published in the Huffington Post, National Review, FoxNews.com, CNN.com, TodayMoms.com, among many others. She's a board member on the State of Wisconsin Commission on the Future of Women and Children, which advised Governor Scott Walker on policies affecting economically vulnerable women and families. She's currently signed to do her first children's book, which she knows quite a bit about because she is the mother of 8, how about that? And still has time to fly out here today. There we go, some applause, here we go. She's a graduate of Arizona State where she got her BA in economics and then her master's degree in international affairs from UC San Diego. And the part that's political also is she is married to a congressman, Congressman Duffy, representing Wisconsin. Please welcome Rachel Campos Duffy today. Sorry, what?
For me as a parent, it's important
regular green normal
to still appreciate how lucky we are to live in this country and the kind of sacrifices that their great-grandfather and their grandfather made so that they could have a better life.
How do I get full screen on this one?
You press full screen.
What is it?
On your slideshow to your right. There.
All right.
God speaks.
For me as a parent, it's important for my kids to still appreciate how lucky we are to live in this country and the kind of sacrifices that their great-grandfather and their grandfather made so that they could have a better life. My name is Rachel Campos Duffy. As a mother of 6, nothing is more important to me than my family. My grandparents came from Mexico, and my father was born in a small copper mining town in Arizona. They were very poor, but they were very resourceful. And so, even as a young kid, he was a shoeshine boy. He started his own pinata business when he was only 12 years old. So he's somebody who figured out at a very young age that what he couldn't do in Mexico, he could do in America, which was to transcend his poverty through hard work. When I was growing up, my dad was often in night school, earning his degree. And I think what he passed on to us, he didn't really tell us, he showed us. You know, Hispanics were not a monolithic group, but I think what we share, the most important thing we share, is a work ethic, is a drive, is a willingness to sacrifice for the next generation.
The reason why America is distinct from the rest of the world is because you can do whatever you want to do as long as you set your mind and establish your goals, you can do it.
This country gave my family the freedom and the opportunity to succeed.
So first of all, thank you so much for having me here. I'm thrilled to be here. My husband and I actually first met on a reality television show that's been going on for, I don't know, maybe 25 years now on MTV called The Real World. I'm very old, I'm 46 years old, so I was in the third season. And my husband was on the fifth, so we met actually on one of their reunion shows. And we are actually the very first reality TV marriage couple. We've been together for going on 19 years now, and we have 8 children. That video was taken 2 children ago. and we're definitely the most fertile reality television couple as well. My husband, so that was me on The Real World San Francisco, by the way. I was here in San Francisco. And my husband was on the Boston Real World. And as I said, we met on a reunion. Sean is actually the very first reality television national politician. So as you know, Donald Trump is, a lot of people think he's the first. He's actually the second. Depending on what you think about President Trump, you can either thank or blame my husband for that. There he is now. I think when people hear my resume, the thing that really jumps out at them the most is not reality TV or anything else. What really jumps out at them is that I have 8 kids, right? And so I thought I'd just give you an idea. That's my family there. I was taken last year, so everybody's a little older. In fact, people often ask me, what is it like to raise that many kids in such a hyper-political environment? Dad's a Republican politician, mom is a conservative activist, a Fox News contributor. And so I always tell the story. First of all, there are weird things that happen when you have that much politics in your family. I have a little 3-year-old. She has a little baby doll, a little black, beautiful black baby doll that she has named Baby Trump. So she hears that Trump word a lot, and so it's not as much of a pejorative in our home, so she likes Baby Trump. But I think that this story about my son Jack, he's the one right there, actually happened when he was only 12 years old, shortly after my husband was elected, maybe a year or two after. And we used to have in our home a basement room that we called the toy room, and I went down into the toy room, and it was an absolute wreck. And of course, I gathered all the children together, and I said, hey guys, you guys have to pick this up. And I left, and I came back about 15, 20 minutes later, and the room looked exactly the same as when I had just, when I had just been down there. So I said, what happened here? I said, told you guys to clean up this mess, it's still like that. And my son said, look, Mom, me and Evita's the oldest one there, me and Evita, we did our part. Everything you see on the ground right here, this all belongs to all the little kids. And I said what probably most of your moms would say. I said, I don't care who made the mess. Nobody is leaving the toy room until this is all done. And Jack walked across the room to pick up a toy, and I heard him mumble something. And I said, did you just say something, Jack? And he said, no, I didn't say anything. And I said, well, I really distinctly heard you mumble. And he said, I didn't say anything. And I said, Jack, what did you say? And he said, fine. I called you a socialist. And that's what it's like in my house. In the United States, about 18% of the population is Hispanic. At UC-Berkeley, it's about 13% Hispanic. Today, Latina young women are enrolling at colleges and universities at higher rates than even non-Hispanic women. A lot of people don't know this about Hispanics, but they start businesses at 3 times the rate of the average American. And Hispanic women are actually starting businesses at an even faster clip than them. I always say that I don't think Latino women need Sheryl Sandberg or anyone else to tell us to lean in. We have been. As the influence of Hispanic women continues to grow, a Latina-centered version of American feminism is beginning to emerge. A feminism, I argue, that is not tethered to the narrow agenda of abortion rights. Latina feminism celebrates the importance of men. It celebrates the importance of family, of children, of cooperation, and hard work. Latina empowerment reflects our faith. We are predominantly Catholic, and our Hispanic cultural experiences and values, rather than the very narrow definitions of success offered by old guard feminists and white urban professional women. It is a feminism that isn't angry or vulgar. It's unabashedly pro-family, it's unabashedly pro-life, and it celebrates our fertility and our unique contributions to the human family. Now, we'll talk a little bit later on in my discussion about what I call Latina feminism. First, I'd like to start this lecture by telling you a little bit about my parents, because I am so very proud of them, but also because I think it explains a lot about why I feel the need to be part of this great political and policy debate that our country is in right now. Now, my family, like so many of your families, chose America for a reason. It is not random. We did not put on a blindfold and randomly pick America on a map as a destination. There are ideas, there are values, and a creative culture that is unique to America that makes it possible for families like mine to rise out of poverty and into the ranks of the middle class and beyond. I always say that there is a secret sauce for America. The ingredients, if you will, of the American dream. Freedom, limited government, free enterprise, hard work, and personal responsibility. That's it. That, to me, is America in a nutshell. And every generation must fight to preserve these ideas for the next generation. And that is why I travel to places like Berkeley to talk to young people about these ideas. These ideas and the opportunity and the prosperity that comes from them are sadly and too often undermined by some university professors. These ideas will die unless young people like you learn about them and join in the fight to preserve the American dream. Now, my father's parents came to America from Mexico. And as you learned in that video, my dad was born in a small copper mining town in Arizona called Sonora. He was the 11th of 15 kids, so you guys thought I had a lot of kids. My dad's family was poorer than most. And in Sonora, Arizona, that was really saying something. The Campos siblings had one green pipe to share among all the 15 siblings. And my dad recounts when he does, you can still see the pain in his eyes. He recounts a very painful memory in kindergarten when a fellow classmate very cruelly pulled down his pants to reveal the depth of his poverty, which of course was his bare bottom. You see, my father's family was so poor that they could not afford underwear. But out of that poverty, and even the occasional humiliation, came a work ethic and a resourcefulness that I believe has been his greatest asset. So in addition to being a shoeshine boy, my dad and his brothers were young entrepreneurs, something Hispanics know a lot about. They picked, cut, cleaned, and sold cactus leaves that they gathered from the desert mountains to sell door to door. Later on, he became an apprentice to a local piñata maker. At the tender age of 12, and with the help of his mother who made the glue with flour and water on the stove, and she also helped him place his products in the markets, my dad started his own piñata business. Now at the age of 18, my father joined the U.S. Air Force, where he met my mother while he was stationed in Spain. And he married her and they started a family. Even as a soldier in the U.S. Air Force, my dad was not above taking extra work after hours. After a long day of serving on the base and working there, he'd wash dishes at night at a Chinese restaurant. My mother, who still was not yet fluent in English, swept floors at a beauty salon. My parents would do anything to get their little family ahead, and they did so much. I think growing up seeing my parents' work ethic is what made me decide that I had actually indeed made the right decision marrying Sean Duffy. When I was pregnant with our first child, my husband Sean was still in law school. He was in his last semester. And one of the ways that my husband put himself through law school and supported us as a family was, I don't know if you know Sean, my husband, it's another quirky thing about him. He is a three-time world champion lumberjack speed climber. He was in his younger days. I don't know if you've ever seen this on ESPN. If you turn it on at like 3 a.m., you'll see these guys log rolling, chopping, sawing, but the most exciting competition for lumberjack sports. And by the way, his hometown is Hayward, Wisconsin, which is the home of the world champion lumberjack competition. They have these huge 90-foot trees. And so you climb these trees, speeding really fast, and you basically almost free fall down, and that's the competition. It's very challenging, very athletic. He was a three-time world champion. And so one of the things he did was go around the country with other groups of lumberjacks, and they put on these exhibition competitions, and he would make money that way. But in between the shows, there'd be, I don't know, about a 45-hour wait between some of the shows. And it's very grueling, because in these competitions or in these exhibitions, they're climbing, they're sawing, they're chopping, they're log rolling. And so the temptation is to sit and rest. But one of the things they would do is maybe there'd be some scraps of wood, and they'd make these little chairs out of, so there he is competing, that's the speed climb. But they'd make these little chairs with their saws, or their chainsaws. And you'd usually make one or two, because you need to rest. However, when Sean knew that we were having a baby, he was pretty stressed out, and by the way, these chairs, they sell for about $5 or $10 a chair to the people that would come in. Like I said, he'd usually make three to five chairs maybe, but when he realized he was having a baby and he was so worried about how he was going to support this family, he was cranking out chairs at an amazing clip, no rest between shows, and that is when I knew for sure that I actually picked a very good egg indeed, because like my own father, my husband would do anything to get his little family ahead. Now, while working hard to raise a family, my mom and dad figured out that education was the fastest route to the middle class that they so wanted their kids to be a part of. And so when I was growing up, my dad, after work, was often in night school, earning his degree. My mother taught herself English because she knew that in America, English was the language of opportunity. She got her GED in night school when I was in kindergarten. And years later, when my mother was in her late 40s and I was a sophomore at Arizona State University, I was about 19 years old, I found out that my mom had just enrolled as a freshman at ASU. Now, at that time, I was not very happy to learn that my mom was going to college with me. You can imagine what it's like to be a young person bumping into your mom on campus, which happened often, or having her drop by your dorm room, which she is Latina, so she had no qualms about that. We actually took a Spanish poetry class together, and we graduated 1 year apart. But I can tell you now, one of my greatest regrets as an adult is that I did not have the maturity or the wisdom to appreciate back then what a truly courageous thing that was for her to do at that age, of course, in a second language. My parents taught us by example about education, about opportunity, and about the American dream. And I think the most important thing that my parents taught me and my siblings was that, one, you're never too old to learn, and two, that we are not victims. They always maintain their dignity. They always maintained their optimism, and they taught us to love America and to be grateful to be Americans. Now today, that shoeshine boy is retired comfortably in sunny Arizona with my mom. His four grown children all have postgraduate degrees, and his kids and his 16 grandkids, most of them are mine by the way, live lives that surpass even his wildest childhood dreams. Now my family, like so many of yours, is the embodiment of the American dream. And for that, I tell you, I am eternally grateful. Now, increasingly, I believe that our culture is turning to entitlements and depending more and more on government instead of the self-initiative and hard work that was the source of my parents' efforts and has always been the source of America and our Hispanic communities. Our government began regulating and taxing in ways that really hurt Hispanics, and who, by the way, as we've talked about before, are America's most entrepreneurial demographic. Now, under Barack Obama, regulations exploded at an unprecedented pace, and small businesses were forced to scale back growth or shutter their businesses altogether. It is not often reported, but during Obama's 8 years in office, 2 million Hispanics fell into poverty. Income inequality, something that President Obama really ran on, actually got worse under his presidency. And Obamacare regulations turned once full-time work into part-time jobs that couldn't support a family because a lot of employers had to turn those jobs into part-time to, if not, they'd have to meet those mandates by Obamacare and their businesses would not have survived. Today, one of the most underreported, and I work for Fox Business, and I also, as you know, have a degree in economics, I think one of the most underreported stories of this presidency is the volume of regulation President Trump is rolling back. And it is the source of so much of the record-breaking economic growth that we are finally seeing. It's why we are seeing the job market grow in industries the Obama administration said were gone forever. Manufacturing, logging, mining, the energy sector, and Main Street small businesses. The mom and pop stores that so many Latino families dream of owning and growing and passing on to their children. Now, even though immigration gets a lot of media attention these days with DACA and other issues, jobs and the economy remain the number one issues for Hispanics. When Hispanics are polled about their top concerns, immigration ranks number 5 after the economy, jobs, education, and healthcare. One of the most important policy ideas that conservatives like me espouse that benefits the Hispanic community greatly is parental choice in education. And I can tell you that as an Hispanic woman, nothing gets my blood boiling more than the hypocrisy of politicians who shut down school choice voucher programs for the poor and for minorities. By the way, that was one of the first things that Obama did when he entered office, was to shut down the opportunity choice programs in the DC district, which actually kicked out people that, minorities who were actually going to the school, Sidwell Friends, where his daughters were going, were actually kicked out of that school because they could no longer afford it because he shut down that opportunity program for them. But of course, this hypocrisy that they send their own children to elite private institutions, both the Clintons and the Obamas sent their daughters to private elementary and secondary schools, many of them with tuition that exceeded the amount that the average Hispanic family even makes in a year. And they did this while fighting against Hispanic and Black parents who wanted the same choices for their kids. It is fundamentally unfair and un-American for your zip code to determine the quality of your education. I believe that access to a good education is a civil right, not a privilege reserved for the wealthy and the well-connected. I will tell you that I truly believe that competition works in education. Now, if I ask my 9-year-old son to run from the front door of our house down to the mailbox, he will run fast. I'm going to ask you this. Will he run faster alone or with his sister? I would posit to you that you do not need 8 children to figure out that my son will run faster if he runs with his sister. Because competition makes us run faster. It forces businesses and institutions, including the education system, to innovate and perform better. Competition works because it's common sense. And I'll tell you this, if you were a conservative on election night, we had a really big win, right? We won the presidency, we won the Senate, and we won the House. If you were a Republican and not a hashtag never Trump Republican, this was actually a really fun and wild night for us. For other people, it was not quite as fun. These were just some of my favorite things. This one's really good. But I will say to you that as a conservative, the win from November can be very deceptive. And I go around and tell Republicans and conservatives all the time not to be fooled by the election in November. when it comes to young people, when it comes to your generation, I do not believe that conservatives won the battle of ideas. If millennials had decided the presidential election, Bernie Sanders would be. I believe that too many of you and your friends and your peers have not connected the historically unprecedented prosperity that you enjoy with the system of government that makes that prosperity possible. Why? Why is that the case? Well, I believe that there is a lot of economic misinformation taught in American high schools, colleges, and universities. The truth is, the fact is, that nothing has lifted more people out of poverty than entrepreneurial capitalism. Nothing. And that is a fact. Another fact is that humans naturally seek freedom, including economic freedom. They leave places like El Salvador and Mexico, where connections to government and power are rewarded instead of ingenuity and hard work. Countries where you cannot count on the rules of law, where corruption and crime run rampant, places where dictators promised utopia but turn their countries into a living hell. Now, I know that Beyonce and the Kardashians and Jay-Z think Cuba is a hip new vacation spot. But I can tell you that for millions of Cubans, it is a place of unspeakable poverty and repression. The dysfunctional centralized economies and the political systems of Cuba, Venezuela, and Bolivia, they leave families desperate and hungry. In Venezuela and Cuba, political rivals are imprisoned. They disappear, or they're executed. Right now, there are over 500 political prisoners in Venezuela who oppose that dictator, Maduro. The brave citizens of Venezuela are doing all they can to fight against socialism and authoritarianism that was first introduced by Hugo Chavez and now Nicolas Maduro. Now, Bernie Sanders, if you guys really like him, Bernie Sanders once praised the socialist revolution of Venezuela. But now that socialism has taken the once richest country, we're only talking about 15 years ago, Venezuela was the richest country in Latin America. It is now one of the poorest. And now Bernie is silent on Venezuela. 6 years ago, his website proclaimed that, quote, "The American dream in the US is dead. We are more likely to find it in Venezuela." He has since quietly removed that statement from his website. I don't know if you guys have been following the stories in Venezuela. They're absolutely heartbreaking. The population, people have lost so much weight from hunger. People are having to give their children over to a neighbor or a friend who might better be able to feed it. Bodies exploding in the morgue because there's no electricity to cool them. There was a fascinating story in the Washington Post about a month and a half ago about how many middle-class, college-educated women are having to go to Colombia and prostitute themselves in order to get food on the table for their children. Do not believe Bernie Sanders and other socialists when they tell you that Venezuela is in the state it is because socialism wasn't implemented properly. It is in the state it is because it has been implemented perfectly. I work for a group called the Libre Initiative. We go out into the Hispanic community, we're a nonprofit, and we talk about these ideas about economic liberty and limited government and policies that we think will empower Hispanics to really thrive in America. And one of the things that we do for the Hispanic community is we have English language classes for them. And I was recently in Miami where we were celebrating the graduation of a bunch of Hispanics from our English language class. Now, this group was full of Latinos from all over, and they all got up and from every country in Latin America, and they all got up and had something to say, and we're so grateful for this class and to this country. But I would tell you that the most poignant, the most emotional testimonies came from the Venezuelans. And the reason, of course, is because these were the lucky ones who just recently escaped Venezuela, some of them actually, you know, 10 years ago, others more recently. But this is happening in real time to their country in Venezuela. And one of the men stood up and he said, you know, we really need to talk to our young people. We really need to explain to them these ideas about capitalism and socialism and where it leads. And he said, with tears in his eyes, he said, we need to tell them to beware of free stuff. He said, I don't care if it's a washing machine or a bag of rice. This is how it starts. Nothing, he said, is worth your freedom. Nothing. Now, the brave people of Venezuela are fighting hard for their liberty and to put food in their bellies. In Cuba, after 67 years of the Castros, many have grown weary, but others still thirst for the freedom that you and I take for granted. So the next time you open a fashion magazine, as I did with the Wall Street Journal Weekend Magazine, and you see a photo spread glamorizing retro Havana, think about the repression and the poverty that would drive a mother to put herself and her newborn baby in a rickety raft in shark-infested waters in the hopes of reaching America. Immigrants come to America for freedom, the freedom to work and the freedom to prosper. I believe Ronald Reagan had it right when he said, work and families are the center of our lives, the foundation of our dignity as a free people. The question that I think you should be asking yourself is, what political party has the ideas and the policies to lift families out of poverty? And which party wants to give you scraps off the government table to make you dependent and comfortable in your poverty? Now, like so many other universities, students at UC Berkeley debate the merits of economic justice and the benefits of socialism versus entrepreneurial capitalism. And I think that this discussion is incomplete without an understanding and an appreciation for the reasons why immigrants risk everything to come to America. Think about it. There are 800,000 dreamers clamoring for American citizenship, or at least legal status, in our country. Their parents and their grandparents would also like to enjoy this status. Do you ever wonder why there aren't 800,000 American kids protesting and clamoring to become citizens of Mexico, El Salvador, Argentina, Venezuela, Cuba? I think it's time that we as Americans, as well as the Dreamers, by the way, think a lot more deeply about why this is the case. There are reasons. Our Constitution, rule of law, free markets, limited government, free speech, and political civility. Political civility. The faculty and the students of Berkeley, I think, need to think about this. And so should the Dreamers. Recently, they shouted down an elected representative of the American people, Representative Nancy Pelosi, and they actually caused her to shut down her public town hall. I would say to those Dreamers that political civility, free speech, all of these things that we talked about, these are timeless values, and they are why people come to America, whether these angry activists recognize that or not. Now, Hispanics come to America risking everything to work hard and to create their own destiny. Plain and simple, I will say to you, Hispanics care about small business, taxes, regulations, economic liberty, and some of us don't even know what that means. Here's what I do know from years of working and speaking with Hispanics across the country. Hispanics do not reject the principles of free markets, limited government, individual liberty, parental choice in education, and personal responsibility. There is simply an absence of these voices promoting these ideas in our communities. When Hispanics actually hear these ideas, they say to me and to other conservatives, why hasn't anyone told me about these ideas before? I'm sorry, I lost my place here.
is Daniel Garza, and my American experience started off here. I grew up picking crops with my family. My parents were immigrants from Mexico with nothing but a fourth grade education. We were so poor. My siblings and I would often miss school to work in the fields. Our home was the size of a tool shed. Had no running water, and what we would do is warm buckets of water on the stove so that when my parents returned from work in the field, they would bathe with small cups. My father never took welfare because he didn't want to depend on anyone to produce his dignity. He is a proud and noble man.
He can make it with just three things. He's got good credit and freedom. Liberty to work. And that's what the United States is.
You know, I didn't know it at the time, but my father began saving money and buying and selling small properties. He bought a motel with the profit he made. My family and I spent long hours fixing up that motel while still working the fields. My father continued to buy and sell property, and one day he and my mother retired with enough money to live comfortably for the rest of their lives.
If I don't come to the United States, I don't think I have the life that we got right now. Living so good, you know.
My parents' American dream had become a reality. My family and I have succeeded by following the path to freedom. But that path is on the verge of vanishing. What we're starting to see here in America now is a growth in the size and the scope of government that is now starting to look like the governments that we left behind. I'm just torn apart when I see folks who are caught in this dependency that government offers. And not only that, they've condemned their children to a life of mediocrity and subsistence. That this is not the American dream. This is an American nightmare. The Libre Initiative is reaching the Hispanic community before they are lost forever. We know advancing economic freedom is the best way to improve human well-being, especially those at the bottom. And that's our message to the world. You know, one day I was speaking before a group of 150 evangelical Hispanic ministers in South Texas, and a man stood up. He had tears in his eyes and said, you know, I've never heard these things before. Why has nobody told us? Most Hispanics have never even heard about economic freedom, but they know it. Cuba, Venezuela, Mexico. Hispanics leave countries that have been ruined by tyranny to come to America, the land of the free. They don't just believe in the cause, they lived it. It is a privilege to live in the United States because this is a nation where you dictate your destiny. No other nation has fulfilled more dreams and more aspirations than this country. And to have been born here, I'm just grateful to God for that.
Learn how you can get involved at joinlibre.org.
Market ideas are not just popular with hardworking immigrants seeking upward mobility. Our ideas are also attractive to aspirational young people. Now, you might not believe it if you look at popular culture where, you know, your college peers sport Che Guevara t-shirts and they pine for the days of the Bernie Sanders rallies. But I will tell you that Reason Magazine reported that millennials, this is very interesting, millennials who did not go to college have more favorable views of capitalism. Wonder why. But here's another interesting fact. Turns out that a lot of young people don't even know what socialism means. So when you switch out the word socialism for its definition, an economy managed by the government, that's its definition, and then you poll the same group of millennials, they actually prefer a free market economy to an economy managed by the government. One of the reasons might be, I bet if we polled young people and asked them if the government should take over the internet, or Apple, or Uber, or Facebook, or further regulate their microbreweries, or their favorite Korean-Mexican fusion taco truck, I think they would all prefer that the government not take over those entities. I know it's cool for celebrities like Matt Damon and Kanye West to rail against the man and capitalism, the very system that made them ridiculously wealthy. There's no doubt that in popular culture, voices in defense of liberty and free market are scarce. But I want you to take a look at this video and tell me, maybe, just maybe, these celebrities are maybe closet conservatives, or maybe just libertarians, you tell me.
Think about the last 5 years. Enter our protagonist. Enter the most powerful force for change on the continent. Enter the strongest, loudest, clearest voice for progress. Enter commerce. Entrepreneurial capitalism takes more people out of poverty than aid, of course, we know that.
I believe that opportunity looks a lot like hard work. When I was 13, I had my first job with my dad carrying shingles up to the roof. And then I got a job washing dishes at a restaurant. And then I got a job in a grocery store deli. And then I got a job in a factory sweeping Cheerio dust off the ground. And I've never had a job in my life that I was better than. And every job I had was a stepping stone to my next job. And I never quit my job until I had my next job. And so opportunities look a lot like work.
To all my little homeboys and homegirls back in the city, I came up in that same county building. Food stamps, welfare, Section 8. Check it out. You looking at me on TV right now, this is living proof that you can do anything you put your mind to, you feel me? Real talk. They call us the minority, you know, the black and brown, blacks, Latinos, but for sure, if you keep love, God, respect, and hard work in your heart, you can do anything you want in life, all right?
I mean, it's all about hard work, I think. For me, that's what it was about. I went and I took dance classes and I offered my help to work at the desk so I could take all the free dance classes that I wanted. Because that's what I wanted to do. I think eventually hard work, dedication, and a willingness to learn everything without any ego is what is really the recipe for success. And you have to really know who you are. You really have to remember where you started, who you are, and nobody can change that.
Now, if you would just indulge me for a second, I want to talk to you a little bit about feminism and how I believe Latina pro-life women like me are actually redefining it. Over the past year, we've seen huge feminist protest marches, most notably the Women's March that took place the day after the president's election. Now, I was there, so despite what Sean Spicer and the president say, I can tell you from an eyewitness point of view that the Women's March, hands down, drew bigger crowds than the presidential inauguration. Not a question. I saw them both. I know this to be true because I saw them, and I can tell you there were at least 500,000 people at the Women's March. And I have to tell you, I was really impressed. It was an amazing turnout, and it deserves credit for that because, let's face it, it was on the heels of a very depressing defeat, and that they were able to organize that quickly and in such masses was just, it was noteworthy. It was impressive. But I have to tell you that as a conservative observer of the march, the size of the crowd was not the only thing that caught my attention. In fact, what really caught my attention was the vulgarity on display at the march. It was very off-putting to me, to say the least. We were actually in DC touring. I found it very disturbing. I will tell you that in my opinion, I think our power as women comes from being as crass and as vulgar as the lowest common denominator of the opposite sex. I think our power comes from using our gender and our femininity to elevate the debate. Whatever happened to when they go low, we go high? If Trump's vulgarity offends, and I believe it does in many cases, we lose our moral high ground when we, as a gender, go there too. Another thing that caught my attention happened days before the march, when a pro-life feminist group called New Wave Feminists had their partnership status with the Women's March revoked. That is, they were literally kicked off of the march. They were not allowed to be part of this event, simply because they were pro-life. Now remember, this was a group that was also very anti-Trump. They were kicked out because they were pro-life. In fact, it was even more ironic because the event was, one of the main leaders was a woman named Linda Sarsour, who is pro-Sharia, actually is on Twitter having defended female genital mutilation, but pro-life women were not. We were way too offensive to be part of the group. I believe that this kind of pretty much sums up what the debate was, to be fair. So that's one person's response. That's another person's response. American feminism, in my opinion, has evolved to become almost exclusively about abortion rights. As a conservative woman, this is very perplexing. Feminism, like so many other progressive movements, was supposed to be about expanding rights to more and more people, especially the most vulnerable among us. Surely, a helpless unborn child fits that definition. Moreover, the movement purports to protect women from violence and exploitation. What could be more violent than abortion? And what could be more exploitative than taking money from a woman who feels desperate and trapped and pitting her against her own child? I believe that women deserve better. And as a culture, I believe that we must do better at providing non-violent alternatives and solutions for women facing difficult pregnancies. The pro-choice movement is also losing credibility as a result of technology. If you have ever seen a 4D ultrasound, which I indeed have, you simply cannot deny the humanity of a fetus or the incredible medical advances in understanding fetal development. They have grown since the first child I had to the next. The ultrasounds that I saw when my first child was born in 1999 to when my child was born was a year and a half years old. It is incredible if you see an 4D ultrasound. I believe that pro-choicers are science deniers. They are the flat earthers of our day. But go see a 4D ultrasound for yourself and tell me that's not a human being. But putting the issue of abortion aside, the march in Washington also exposed the deep intolerance liberals purport to be against. Pro-life women who attended, friends of mine, were spat on. Madonna said she dreamt of blowing up the White House, and the hypocrisy of liberal mantras for more tolerance or to coexist and love Trump's hate was best captured by a woman on a plane a few days after the inauguration who refused to even sit next to a Trump supporter on an airplane. Now this video went viral, you can Google it, it's fascinating. So the question is, who are conservative women? What do we know about them? Do they deserve to be called feminists too? And how are Latina women influencing conservative feminism? Well, it turns out that there is some recent research on women that shed some light on this subject. How are we doing on time?
We're out of time.
I'm so sorry. I'll take a few questions if you have.
No, we can't do that. No, you got to come up front. Huge thank you to Rachel for coming out, flying out from Wisconsin. Thank you to Tyrese Winters. See you at the final exam in 2 weeks. Come on up, get a brochure about the Institute, and talk to Rachel.